This video series is to accompany the Cisco Netacad IT Essentials 7.0 course. This video covers Chapter 2, PC Assembly. Chapter 2, we're going to look at assembling the computer, and if you're in the course, you'll be doing a lab to put a computer together. But we're going to look at general and fire safety standards, connecting the power supply, installing the motherboard components, installing internal drives, installing the adapter cards, identifying additional storage, and connecting computer components with appropriate cables. 2.1, assemble the computer. First, what you want to do is open your case up and check the model type to make sure that the motherboard does match the case. The motherboard is going to determine the type of case that you use. The size and shape must match. So when you are purchasing or doing a spec on computer parts, your motherboard and your case are some of the first decisions that you make. What type of case are you going to have? Will your motherboard fit inside of it? Will your graphics card fit inside of it? Will all the components, you know, if you're going to do a water cooler, what type of fans you're going to put in? Will everything fit inside that case? And will it all match up on the motherboard? So the size, how much components you're going to need, room for airflow to keep the system cool, all that comes into play. What type of power supply is another consideration. You want to make sure that the power supply rating and connection type does match the motherboard. Also, there's a lot of case designs to choose from. 20 years ago, you had one, maybe two different types of models. Everything was closed on the side. Now you have open-sided with glass or some type of plexiglass. Most computers come where you can see inside of them. You have the different RGB lights that people like to put in on their computers. When you're talking about business computers and just everyday computers, those are going to be all closed and those are going to be kind of standard. But for gaming computers and most computers that people are wanting put together or constructed are going to have different looks to them. LEDs mounted on the outside of the case tell you if the system has power. When the hard drive is in use, that's the status displays. And when the computer is in sleep or hibernation mode, you'll also have vents on the cases. You'll have a vent for the power supply. You also have vents in the back to draw air out of the system. In some cases, even have more vents than that. My particular case that I use has vents drawing air, three fans on the front. It's got two fans on the top, a fan on the back, and then, of course, the vents for the power supply as well. So it's got a lot of in and out of airflow happening. So on the case size, you want to consider larger cases often require larger fans because the smaller fans cannot create enough airflow. So you want to make sure that that's a good consideration. Usually, though, if you're purchasing a specialized case, they're going to recommend what fans go with it, what size of fans you're going to put in. Your fan speeds, are you going to be able to vary the control of those? Larger fans spin a little bit more slowly than smaller fans, which can reduce some fan noise, so that can be a consideration. The number of components that you're going to put inside of the computer, multiple components, you know, can you put multiple graphics cards in? Do you want to add or do you want to put a TV tuner card in? Or do you want to put some kind of video capture card in? Are you going to have enough space in your case for that? Physical environment. The case fans must be able to disperse enough heat to keep the interior of the case cool. So the location of the computer, if you're working with business computers, and one of the examples I can give you is when I've worked in the past, there was a particular computer that was out in a warehouse area. There was a lot of dirt and grime, so we had to put extra filters on the intake of the computer, and we also had to make sure that the fans were turned up to a higher speed so that they could draw air through those filters, and we had to clean them more often. We had to clean them about once a month to make sure that they were working right, and we just had to have a different, it was just a different aspect because of the location or the environment of the computer. The number of mounting places available, different cases have different numbers of mounting places for fans inside of them. That's a consideration to think about. The location of mounting places, there's different locations for the fans, so the location and the number. And then also electrical connections. Some case fans are connected directly to the motherboard, while others are connected directly to the power supply. In some cases, you have external power. I know Corsair sells a controller board where you plug that into the motherboard, and then the fans all plug into a main controller and drive their power off from that. The type of motherboard is a consideration for the power supply. The power supply must be compatible with the motherboard. And then also checking your required wattage. You want to add wattage for each component. And if the wattage is not listed on a component, calculate it by multiplying its voltage and amperage. If the component requires different levels of wattage, use the higher number. You always want to have more than just be on the edge. You always want to calculate and then have a little bit more, because if you ever have spikes in that you need more power, it can cause a problem if you don't have the power supply that's giving you enough, that's supplying enough power. So if you calculate it up and you say, oh, I'm only going to need 200 watts of power, still do like a 3 or 350. When I calculated mine up, I knew I was going to need about 400. I went with the 750, 800 range just to make sure I had enough on there. And if you're going to be upgrading components in the future, you want to make sure that you might not necessarily have to upgrade that power supply, but you don't want to have to upgrade the power supply and components at the same time. Let's say you have one graphics card, you're going to add a newer level of graphics card and it requires more wattage. You want to make sure that you think about future needs. And then number of components, types of components, and then the type of case that the power supply, where is it going to fit in the case and how is it going to be mounted. Then you're going to select your motherboard. When you're doing a replacement motherboard, you want to make sure that it supports all and accommodates all of your current components. Make sure that the current motherboard meets the recommendations for the CPU. This is a replacement. If you're replacing just the motherboard, make sure that that's your CPU, your RAM, your video card, the socket and chipset on the motherboard are compatible with the CPU, the existing heat sinks and fans and assemblies when reusing the CPU. Make sure that those are all going to work in the new motherboard. The number of type of expansion slots are going to be a match. And the existing power supply connections need to fit the new motherboard as well. And it also needs to fit in the new case. That's the big thing. It's got to fit in the new case. This is an older list here on the PowerPoint that we're doing here. Chips come out all the time. I considered going and looking up a new list and putting on this presentation, but it just wasn't worth my time, because by the 6 months from the time I record this video, you're going to have new chips come out. A year from now, a year to it, in a year and a half after this video is recorded, there's going to be a new chips out. So just go check the internet for AMD sockets and Intel sockets. Those are the two main chips that you're going to be using in personal computers. But the thing you need to consider is socket type. The heat sink or fan type must match the socket type. The physical specifications of the motherboard. And just as a note, the CPU will be tied to the type of motherboard. In other words, the motherboard will either be for Intel or AMD. So you won't be able to put an AMD on an Intel or an AMD motherboard. The motherboard will be designed for either AMD or Intel manufacturer. So that's a consideration. So when you're checking, usually what you're doing is you're buying your motherboard and your CPU in tandem. Those are going to come as a package deal, because you want to make sure that those match up the most. And then everything else, then kind of your memory and your graphics cards and other things like that can match up as well. But your CPU and your motherboard really have to be your first considerations. You also have to look at the case size. The heat sink and the fan must fit within the case, and then the physical environment as well. So your heat sink and your fans must disperse enough. They need to disperse enough heat to keep the CPU cooled. RAM is your next consideration. New RAM may be needed when an application locks up or it's not working right or you're getting error messages. So what you can do is you can execute the RAM test in the BIOS to check the RAM. There's also, depending upon the company that sells the RAM, there's some tests that you can run. They have some software that can check the RAM to make sure it's working fine. The speed of the new RAM must be supported by the chipset on the motherboard. There are two different types of memory. You have unbuffered memory, and just as a note, you do need to know these two types for the exams in this course and for the CompTIA exam. The unbuffered memory, that's regular memory for computers. It reads data directly from the memory banks, making it faster than buffered memory. And then buffered memory is specialized memory for servers and high-end workstations. It's for computers that use large amounts of RAM. They have a control chip built into the module that assists the memory controller in managing that large chunks of information that gets sent back and forth. Next, you're going to select your hard drives, whether it's a spin drive, but you need to look at the form factors of, do you want internal or external? Do you want a hard disk drive, a solid state drive, Do you want it to be hot swappable? Like for a server, are you going to want to be able to pull it out while the operating system's running? What type of heat generation is going to happen? You know, are you going to need extra cooling? Are you going to need power for that? Noise generation. Spin drives do create more noise than SSD drives, but SSD drives are more expensive. So that's a consideration. Then you need to look at optical drives. If you even have an optical drive, do you do an external one? Do you do an internal one? And then what capabilities do you want to have? Are you going to have Blu-ray? Are you going to have a DVD? Or you're going to have an older CD? You may be working on computers with CD or DVD CD writers. So you want to make sure that you, and it's on the exams as well. So you want to make sure that you understand the different form factors. Then you're going to install the hard drive. Depending upon the size, you have the 5 1/4. That's commonly used for the optical drive size. That's a lot of full size tower cases have those. They usually have two or more bays. And then you have the 3 1/2 inch. That's usually more common now in most computers. They provide additional USB ports and smart card readers. Most full size towers will have two or more internal bays for 3 1/2 inch. And then the 2 1/2 inch is what I consider the laptop size, but that's usually what the size of the SSDs come in. That's the smallest bay. And those are most popular in 2021, 2022 timeframe of when this video is being recorded. This case here is an older style of case, but it shows you that it's got the drive bays here that you can put multiple drive bays in. 5 1/4 goes there. You want to remove the front of the case, and it will depend upon the case manufacturer on how that case is removed. So there's no one way to teach how to remove a case. You usually have to look on the internet or look at the manufacturer supplied information to be able to see how to remove that case. But you're going to remove the casing, then you're going to position the drive, slide it in, you know, put the screws in, and then slide it in. And you don't want to over tighten the screws, by the way. You want to make sure that you have them all kind of in and then go back through and tighten them all up, but you want to you don't want to over tighten or strip any screws out as well. Next, you're going to select your adapter cards. They're designed for specific tasks, such as a graphics card, a sound card, a capture card. And so there's different types. You have your peripheral component interconnect, peripheral component interconnect, or PCI. And then you have PCIe, or PCI Express. And there's four types of those, the ×1, ×4, ×8, and ×16. And those are going to look different. So the PCI might look like that, PCIe, and then the PCI ×16 is going to be larger. And then the PCI, there's other factors for adapter card selection. You might have the graphics card, you might have a capture card that goes in. So before you purchase an adapter card, you need to consider the following questions. What are the user's current and future needs? Is there an open and compatible expansion slot available? And what are the possible configuration options? And I will add another question is, when you put that extra cards into your computer, are you going to have enough cooling? Is there going to be enough airflow? Do you have enough airflow going through that case to make sure that you're cooling those extra devices? When you install the adapter cards, you would just want to make sure that you remove the components necessary. These are the little wafers. You remove these slots off the back. It depends on the case on how you're going to do this. Some you just open them up and you can remove these screws right here, and that would remove this little slot, spacer slot, which allows airflow out and in. And then you would put your card in, but you need to make sure that the length of your video card is going to fit. One of the things I ran into with the case that I purchased, I could not put a video card and a water cooler in the case that I purchased because it was a smaller case. And so it just would not fit together. So I didn't go with water cooling, which I didn't want to anyway. I went with air cooling. But it's water cooling is a little bit quieter, but it's a little more expensive as well. Then if you're going to put a media reader in, this would go into the hard drive slots, and then the media reader would allow you to be able to plug in. I usually don't put media readers in, but you may come across this if you're working on a computer for a business and they want that type of support. I usually do this external through a USB cable and just buy an external reader, but some businesses might want those installed on a computer. You also have external storage, USB flash drives, that plug into your USB, eSAT, or Thunderbolt ports. You want to make sure that you have the correct type of external storage for the customer's needs. If they only need a small amount of data, then you might get a USB drive. And I mean, at the time of this recording, you can pick up a 256 meg USB drive for about $20. It's really cheap compared to where they were that, you know, a few years ago, those were running $60 to $100 for 256 meg. And so you can get a lot of storage now on a USB drive for portability. When you go to install all the components, you're going to have to install the front panel cables. That's your LEDs or the lights, your reset switch, your power LEDs, and your power switch. I would recommend checking with the manufacturer for the motherboard to make sure which ones go where. Usually on the motherboard, you're going to see printed on the motherboard the light. It'll tell you, so like power for hard disk drive. So that's your hard disk drive, you know, LED, your power switch, the reset button, speaker button. And so you'll have to plug these little posts here will go inside these, and they're sometimes difficult to get plugged in. So you might have a power button. The most common is you're going to have a power button, a reset button, a power LED, drive activity, LED lights, system speakers, and audio. Mine doesn't have it. I didn't hook my system speaker and audio because I don't have a system speaker hooked up on mine or audio. But that you might have it or you might not, depending on it. But you want to check with the manufacturer to make sure that you're getting the right pins or the right connectors in on the right pins. And then you're also following to make sure that you're getting the pluses and the minuses right. Next, you're going to install in the front panel cables as far as the USB devices that get plugged in. You want to make sure, usually those are only, there's usually a little plastic slot here on your USB, and you see the little opening right there. So you can only plug those in one direction. And you notice that there's a blank spot right there. That's the blank spot there. Actually, the slot is going to be on the other side over there. Not going to be there. It's going to be on the other side. But you just want to check and make sure that you're getting it. Don't force it in, and don't make sure that you're putting it in the right direction, and don't force it in, because you don't want to bend any of those pins in there. And then you should be done. And in this course, you're going to be assembling a computer in the lab. So make sure that you ask your instructor about specifics on the lab and putting those computers together. There's a number of good YouTubers on the internet that install computers frequently. There's a couple of them that do them weekly that are putting computers together. I would recommend watching some videos on putting computers together and getting some experience doing it. Working on some older computers, maybe getting a secondhand computer that doesn't work anymore, pull some parts out and put them back in to get some experience doing that.